Good day, we are the Group 5 and now we are here to present our report about learners with difficulty moving and or walking. So ngayon sa topic po natin na learners with difficulty moving and or walking, ang focus po nito ay ang physical and motor disabilities po ng mga learners, ang kanilang learning characteristics, abilities, tsaka yung support na kinakailangan nilang matanggap sa kanilang mga guro, lalo na kung sila ay nasa inclusive classroom. Dahil tayo po ang mga guro na gagabay, susuporta, mag-educate sa kanila para po hindi sila panghinaan ng loob kahit na may ganong situation po sila. Ano ba muna ang physical disability? Okay, so physical disability is a physical condition that affects a person's mobility, physical capacity, stamina, and dexterity. So napakahirap nang may ganitong kapansanan, 'di ba? Lalo't physical. Kasi napakahalaga ngayon na kikilos ka, gagalaw ka para mag-grow ka, para ma-develop ka. Pero sa physical disability, lahat apektado. Limitado lahat. Paggalaw mo, yung bay, yung kagalingan mo, limitado. Dahil sa physical disability. Halimbawa, kung ikaw ay may kapansanan sa kamay, mahihirapan kang magsulat, mahihirapan kang gumalaw, mahihirapan kang gumawa ng mga bagay na kinakailangang gamitan ng kamay. So, dun pa lang, limitado na lahat. Next is, when a child has difficulty moving and or walking, the physical domain of development is affected. Okay, so tama yan kasi, ano ba muna ang physical domain? Napakahalaga niyan kasi, development siya ng ating body. So, physical changes, which includes growing in size and strength, physical coordination, and the movement of the body. So, kung isang bata ay walang kakayahang gumalaw, maglakad, gumawa ng bagay na kahit simple lang, apektado talaga yung development niya. Kasi di ba nga, sabi nila, yung halimbawa na kapag ang isang tao mag-exercise, edi gagalaw. Tapos, gagawa siya ng way or mag-workout siya. May mabibuild, may mag-grow, may matedevelop, which is yung kanyang muscles, di ba? So, kung sa case ng bata na hindi siya makagalaw, apektado yung development niya, yung pag-grow niya, kahit sa physical changes, mahihirapan. Mayroon pong apat na examples ang physical disability. Una, developmental coordination disorder or dyspraxia. Pangalawa, stereotypic movement disorder. Pangatlo, tics. At ang huli ay ang cerebral palsy. Una muna ay ang developmental coordination disorder or the DCD, also known as dyspraxia. So, dyspraxia is the term na ginagamit ng mga therapists sa kanilang trabaho. Ito ay ang kondisyon na nakakaapekto sa physical coordination. It causes a child to perform less well than expected in daily activities for their age and appear to move clumsily. Another one is, according to DSM-5, American Psychiatric Association 2013, refers to significant and persistent visits in coordinated motor skills that are significantly below expected in typical development. So, ang developmental coordination disorder or the dyspraxia, ito yung mga batang kumikilos ng parang walang pakundangan. Kung sila ba ay makakasagi, kung sila ba ay makakasakit. Ang halimbawa nito ay ang bata ay hindi kayang bumaba ng hagdan. Pangalawa, may hawak siyang bagay, kahit anong bagay, at ito ay kanyang nabibitawan. Ang iba pang halimbawa ay ang mga gawain sa school na mga aktibidad tulad ng pagsulat, kahit simpleng pagkukulay, at kahit nga yung paggamit ng mga gunting. Hindi nila. Another type of motor problem na under pa rin po siya ng example ng physical disability is the stereotypic movement disorder. So, stereotypic movement disorder is a condition in which a person makes repetitive, purposeless movements. Ito yung paulit-ulit nilang nagagawa or ginagawa sa sarili, tapos kahit wala namang katuturan yung bagay na ginagawa nila, nagagawa nila yon. These behaviors interferes with social, academic, or other activities and may result in self-harm or injury. Dahil nga paulit-ulit, hindi nila namamalayan na yung ginagawa nilang yun ay nakakasakit na o hindi na maganda para sa sarili nila. Halimbawa nito, yung nanginginig yung kamay nila, tapos nagsishake, wave, body rocking, head banging, self biting. Kaya nakakatakot, kaya kailangan nila ng gabay para mabantayan sila. Next is tics. Tics are sudden twitches, movements or sounds that people do repeatedly. People who have tics can stop their body from doing these things. So, dito sa tics, condition siya ng nervous systems. Uncontrollable movements of the legs, arms, or even our body. So, halimbawa nito, yung isang tao ay palaging kurap ng kurap. Hindi nila alam na kumukurap na pala sila ng kumukurap. Kumbaga, parang mahahintulad ko siya sa mannerism ng isang tao dahil may kilala ako na ganun din yung lagay niya na lagi siyang kurap ng kurap. So, sabi ko sa kanya, bakit ka kurap ng kurap? Ganun. Tapos sabi niya, mannerism na daw niya yun. So, yung tics para masasabi ko na mahalin tulad ko siya sa mannerism. Kasi, tulad nung sa case ng friend ko, na same lang din sila, na laging nagbiblink yung mata nila, lagi silang kumukurap. Ang panghuli na example ng physical disability ay ang cerebral palsy. So, it is usually caused by a problem that affects the development of a baby's brain while it's growing in the womb. So, nangyayari ito before, during, or after birth due to an accident or injury. Nadadamage yung brain ni baby. Tapos, yung muscle tone affects voluntary movement and full control of the muscles that results in the delay of the child's growth and fine motor development. Nahihirapan na yung develop ng brain dahil naapektuhan pati yung ability ng person para makontrol yung kanyang muscle. There are different classifications of cerebral palsy depending on which parts of the body are affected and the nature of the effects on muscle tone and movement. The term plagia from the Greek word meaning to strike is used with the prefix that indicate the location of limb movement. First is monoplagia. So monoplagia is a paralysis of a single limb, usually an arm. It is a type of paralysis that falls under hemiplegia. Common symptoms are weakness, numbness, and pain in the affected limb. Pangalawa, hemiplegia. Hemiplegia is a condition caused by brain damage or spinal cord injury. Third, triplegia. Three limbs are affected. And the last is quadriplegia. All four limbs, both arm and legs, are affected. Movement of the trunk and face may also be impaired.
Now, after you've learned the definition of learners with difficulty moving and walking, let's now proceed to the identification part. Now, Let me discuss with you the developmental coordination disorder, which is one of the identification of learners with difficulty in moving and walking. Developmental coordination disorder can be defined as difficulties or delays in fine or gross motor movements. It is also referred as dyspraxia, and learners with this kind of condition, usually it affects their physical coordination, they have poor balance, palagi po silang natutumba, nadadapa, they don't have a proper motor planning execution, kaya they cannot be able to do the usual physical tasks that normal students can do. And also, it is not a learning disorder because it does not affect the intelligence of the learners. But it can impact their learning. Like for instance, they might have short attention span for activities or tasks. They might encounter difficulty in remembering things. And all of this because lahat ng ginagawa nila ay limitado lang because of their condition. Kaya naman, palagi silang nag-i-struggle, especially in physical tasks and activities. And this kind of condition ay na-identify na po agad ng family members during the early childhood stage because the signs and the symptoms of this condition are already visible during that stage. And speaking of the signs of developmental coordination disorder, for the developmental stage of early childhood, the signs are yung hindi nila kayang sintasan ang sarili nilang sapatos, wala silang kakayanan na suotan ng damit ang kanilang mga sarili, madalas mali yung pagkakahawak nila ng spoon and fork, at lahat ng nahahawakan nila, palagi nilang nabibitawan. Palagi silang nadadapa, natutumba kapag nagjo-jumping, at they cannot be able to catch or to kick a ball when they are playing. At kapag naglalakad, palagi silang nababangga. And when it comes to the developmental stage of school age, the signs during the early childhood is more visible now, kung saan hindi nagpa-participate ang mga learners pagdating sa mga physical activities such as sports. And they cannot be able to do writing tasks for a longer period of time dahil madalas nilang nabibitawan ang lapis at ballpen kapag nagsusulat. Kaya kailangan pa sila minsan gagabayan ng teacher kapag nagsusulat sila. And if the parents recognize that their child shows any signs of developmental coordination disorder, they can seek medical advice. Kung saan ang specialist for this condition needs to make an assessment first to determine the child's developmental history, to know if the early developmental milestones of the child are delayed, like for example, walking, self-feeding, self-dressing, rolling, kung yung mga bagay na yon ay na-achieve ng bata ng late, it could be a factor na meron siyang developmental coordination disorder. The number 2, to determine the child's intellectual ability, because this condition is a lack of coordination between mental intentions and the ability of the body to carry out those intentions. For example, in the mind of a child, he wants to tie his shoes, but the brain does not properly send the instruction for shoe tying, kaya hindi niya nagawa. Then for number 3, how the child execute his gross and fine motor skills. What is gross motor skills? These are gross movement, come from large muscle groups and whole body movement. Like for example, how the learners do jumping, walking, running, and maintaining balance. Usually, ito pong gross motor skills are exposed when learners are having playtime activities. For the fine motor skills, it is the coordination of small muscles with the synchronization of hands and fingers and with the eyes. For example, how the learners involved with smaller actions such as picking up objects between the thumb and finger, writing carefully, tying shoelaces, and even blinking.
Now I will be discussing why there is a need for assessment. First, to check the child's balance, sensitivity to touch, and performance in gross and fine motor activities. Second is to analyze the child's oral motor coordination. It is necessary to assess child's movement in terms of gross and fine motor activities as well as their oral motor coordination, for this can be a sign that they probably acquired the developmental coordination disorder, which is identifiable in having struggle in physical tasks and activities. Assessing them in their early years is beneficial. To know how we can provide their needs as well as what are the approaches suitable for their condition. All in all, assessment must be conducted in order to identify the needs of a child. This is also the best way in evaluating which approach is applicable for them. Little by little, the progress we can see in them will eventually turn out their best accomplishment that will lead them to strive harder. Therefore, recognizing their improvements and complimenting them is great motivation for them to know that they developed. There are two things that the evaluator needs to check. First, strength and flexibility. By palpating muscle bulk and texture, assessing flexibility of joints, and the quality and intensity of grasp. Second, according to Harris et al. 2015, the motor planning, which includes observing functional fine and gross motor skills and determining hand dominance or lack thereof. This is necessary to be evaluated as this can be a hint that they possess the developmental coordination disorder. The strength of muscle and flexibility of joints is a factor which leads in identifying this kind of disorder. So, if the evaluator observed that the child have difficulty in grasping things and has unnecessary body movements, they have a high possibility that they acquired dyspraxia or the developmental coordination disorder. This is the reason why evaluating them in this aspect at their early age is necessary to get the right medical attention for the improvement of their condition. Now, I will be discussing the stereotypic movement disorder. It is characterized by repetitive, seemingly driven, and apparently purposeless motor behavior. This behavior might look like hand shaking or eye waving, body rocking, head banging, self-biting, or hitting one's own body. Children who display stereotypic movements or behavior often referred as stereotypies. After knowing the developmental motor disorder, I will now discuss the stereotypic movement disorder. This can be easily identifiable as the child develops repetitive and purposeless behavior which sometimes lead in injuring themselves. It is said that this kind of motor disorder is treatable. In addition, approximately 80% of children who develop motor stereotypies will exhibit symptoms before 24 months of age. This can be worsened if the children don't get the proper medical attention, which is reflected through the severity of the non-self-injurious stereotypic movements, ranges from mild to severe interfere. Therefore, the proper way to treat this is to seek for the help of a specialist, which will help them resolve this condition. There are two classifications of stereotypic movement disorder. First is the primary or non-autistic motor stereotypies. These movements usually appear in the first 3 years of a child's life and often continue. Though primary motor stereotypies is fairly common, the cause is unknown. Specialists classify primary when it occurs in typical developing child. Sa madaling sabi po, ang mga bata na may gantong kondisyon ay hindi mahalata sa kanila na may disorder sila kasi nga po ay ang itsura nila ay kagaya lamang ng mga normal na bata na nasa kanilang edad. Kaya din po hindi madaling ma-identify ang cause nito ay dahil po hindi naman makikita sa mga bata na may gantong kondisyon sila unless na sumpungin po siya. Second is the secondary motor stereotypies occur in children who have developmental problems. For example, a child with autism, mental retardation, or vision or hearing impairment. In such cases, where a behavioral or neurological disorder has been diagnosed, the movements are called secondary motor stereotypies. In connection to this, secondary motor stereotypies is associated with any neurological disorder. This is why they are called secondary. As a support, the first cause of their developmental problem is their neurological disorder, and their secondary developmental disorder happens to be the stereotypic movement disorder.
Ngayon ay magtungo naman tayo sa Part C, Learning Characteristics. Motor difficulties and disabilities affects child's ability to perform daily tasks, which includes memory, perception and processing, carrying coordinated movements, and even the speech. As we know, our brain commands our body. Nariyan ang part niya na cerebrum, which is responsible for our senses and thinking ability. Also, meron tayong cerebellum na responsable naman sa motion, motor abilities, at yung mga kakayahan natin na matuto ng mga bagay-bagay. At yung brainstem naman na responsable para sa mga involuntary movements sa katawan natin. Ngayon, if ever na may mag-malfunction sa mga ito, lalong-lalo na yung cerebellum, na posibleng before or after birth mangyari, magkakaroon ito ngayon ng negative impact sa ating daily activities like what happened to those with motor difficulties and disabilities. Just for example, we ask our student to present a group dance performance and from that ay makaklasify natin yung may mga motor difficulties by just simply looking for those na hindi nakakasabay sa beat ng music. Posibleng dahil hirap silang i-recall yung mga dance steps along with the music, so ang nangyayari, they tend to observe others while dancing. Dahilan para hindi nila ma-extend yung mga gestures nila so that they cannot also meet the appropriate speed for those actions. Dito kasi ay kailangan na pagkocombine ng mga bata yung paggamit sa senses and motor skills. Also, kasama rin sa apektado ang speech ability. Kasi kailangan din ng motor control sa articulation at production nito, kung saan ang pagmamalfunction ng dila, labi at jaws ay nagriresulta sa pangit na pagdideliver ng information kahit na maganda pa yung thought na meron ang isang tao. Now let's move on with the negative effects to student psychosocial functioning, kung saan ang first three po ay brought by the developmental coordination disorder, while the separated one po ay brought by the stereotypic movement disorder. Let's begin with the first one. Lower level of self-efficacy and competence in physical and social domains. Meaning, they can control their own motivation, behavior, and social environment. Kasi nga, hirap silang makasabay sa ibang students. Kaya hirap din silang makabuo ng stable connection with them. Na nagdudulot sa kanila ng pagiging ikalawa, depressed, and anxious. Kasi sa realidad, sila yung tipo ng mga estudyante na madalas ay hindi napipili sa mga pangkatang gawain, and this for sure is really hurtful for them. Posible na because of this, i-down nila ng i-down yung sarili nila to the point na pwede nilang maisip na they are just dumbbell sa iba, kaya ayaw silang i-belong sa isang grupo. And all of this can lead to depression that push them to come up with a third externalizing behavior, kung saan nakakapag-violate na sila ng mga social norms na posibleng makasakit na sa ibang tao. Kaya at this point, mahirap na kasi they are not just having the motor difficulties but also mental and emotional difficulties, kung saan they forgot to act properly due to the emotions that they feel. And lastly, the stereotypic movement disorder results to low self-esteem. Dahil dito, ina-underestimate ng isang tao yung kanyang sarili, yung kanyang kakayahan, so that he or she rather choose to withdraw. Mas ginugusto na niya na i-separate yung sarili niya sa iba. Ngayon ay dadako naman tayo sa tinatawag nating range of strengths. Kung saan, na-mentioned na range of strengths must be considered in every disabled person. Kasi every one of us have our own strengths. And those strengths need to be recognized. These strengths serve as a weapon para makasabay tayo sa iba. And also para magkameron tayo ng positive emotion na makakapagbalanse doon sa negatibo. Tulad na lamang ng mga students na may mga motor movement disorder where they may excel in other intelligence that are not controlled by motor functions. Since yung weakness nila ay umiikot sa paggalaw, posible na ang strengths nila ay nasa creativity or sa thinking na mas magbo-bloom if they do really have the passion in it. Dapat may puso sila na handang matuto at handang matrain. They may adequate intelligence, credibility, and language skills depend on the severity of disorders. Syempre, depende pa rin sa level ng disorder nila ang pag-attain nila sa mga nabanggit na qualities. Kumbaga, we need to make some adjustments for them to attain those mentioned skills, and it would be much effective if there is a presence of a supportive adult. Iba kasi yung impact na may nagsusupport, may nagtitiwala at nagaguide sa isang tao. Kasi yun yung mga magmo-motivate sa kanya to continue working, to continuously strive for success. Like for example, yung mga tao na may cerebral palsy. At sabihin natin na yung isa doon ay hindi niya kayang i-move yung mga arms niya until such time na he learned to paint using his mouth and feet just to showcase his talent. At another example, a person with motor difficulty who is good at logical thinking and writing. Pero kailangan niya ng mga assistive technology. And lastly, they need support system that will give them equal opportunity to access learning experience in school alongside with those normally developed students. Here as educators, we need to at least make some adjustments kung paano tayo magpapagawa ng mga activities sa kanila na aligned sa kanilang strengths. Kasi if we're gonna push them to something na hindi talaga nila kaya or nahihirapan sila, it would be unfair for them. Kasi nga may difficulty sila doon eh. And I think it is something that will make them feel bad for themselves.
After we identified the learning characteristics of children with physical disabilities, now let's move on to the general educational adaptations.
For the next topic, it's about the general educational adaptations. First and foremost, we will discuss, according to Kirk et al. From 2015, children with motor difficulties and disabilities need primary intervention with specialists, such as physical and occupational therapists. Sila po ang may responsibilidad para sa pagpaplano ng layunin o pagsaset ng goals sa pagde-develop ng kakayahan ng isang bata, as well as providing teachers and others with information about the child's physical conditions, limitations, and abilities. Sunod naman po ang physical accessibility of schools and classrooms to children with this difficulty or disability. Ang mga sumusunod po ay essential, such as ramps and elevators. Mahalaga po na mayroong ganitong bagay sa lahat ng paaralan, lalo na po kung matataas po ang buildings. Katulad na lamang po ito sa commercial buildings or sa mga malls. Priority nila na may ganitong uri sa kanilang buildings para po sa mga ganitong klaseng disorder. Kung sila nga ay nagpo-provide ng ganito, dapat pati rin po sa paaralan. Mahalaga rin po na dapat may provision of wheelchairs kasi po providing such structures and supports ensure that children with motor difficulty or disability would be able to access as well as move around the classroom safely. May nakaalalay man o wala, mahalaga po at maganda tignan o pagmasdan sila kung sila ay nakakakilos ng malaya sa kung ano ang gusto nilang gawin. Let's proceed to the types of accommodations that will always be relative to the strengths, abilities, and difficulties of the child. For a child with developmental coordination or stereotypic movement disorder na nahihirapan o hindi makasulat base sa kanyang edad, pero magaling naman sa pagsasalita o sa pagde-deliver ng mga words or language skills po, he or she may benefit from being accommodations in the way na maiintindihan nila ang nakikita o nababasa. Table of Classroom Accommodations for Children with DCD and SMD. Ito po yung mga iba't ibang types of accommodations. Una po, response. Kailangan, meron tayo nito sa atin para po ma-deliver natin sa mga bata yung kailangan nilang matutunan. And, assign a peer on adults, ascribe for note-taking, use different sizes of paper and graph paper to align numbers, try different writing tools and pencil grips, use a word processor or computer, use text-to-speech programs, allow oral recitation or test-taking to supplement written tests, and lastly, provide assessment methods. Mahalagang may nakagabay sa kanila o sa mga bata habang ito ay natututo sa mga bagay na nais nitong matutunan.
The second type of accommodation that students with DCD or SMD need to assistance is their setting. Students with learning disabilities are among the most vulnerable at chronic risk for not learning under the aforementioned conditions. Also, for their long-term academic and social problems and for lifelong painful side effects of their classroom experiences. As a result, we may assist them in overcoming their difficulties in the following ways. First is to allow for preferential seating near the teacher. Classrooms are crowded environments arranged to maximize general and not close observation of students. Kaya mas mabuting i-approach natin ng bata kung saan niya nais pumuesto, na kung saan sa tingin niya ay komportable siya. Pero as teachers, automatically alam naman natin kung saan dapat natin sila pinupuesto and dapat malapit sa atin dahil aside sa mapapa-increase ang kanilang approach to learn, ay para mapabilis din tayong makakapunta sa kanila if they need assistance. Example, kung ang bata ay may DCD, which is he or she perform less well, or SMD na hindi talaga niya mapigilan yung kanyang unnecessary movements. Well, much better na sa harapan or sa gilid natin siya pupuin para mayroong open space and maiwasan yung physical injuries mula sa mga bagay na malapit sa kanyang kinaupuan. Second is to adjust chair and or desk height to maximize posture and stability. Yung ordinary school chairs and desks ay minsan insufficient sa kanila para mabigyan sila ng sapat na physical support na kailangan nila in order to study. Habang ang improper desk or chair height naman might hinder them from becoming active participants in classroom activities. So if we want proper learning to happen, high-low seating alternatives and height-adjustable desks are typically necessary. So magkakaroon sila ng maayos na posture if yung uupuan nila has good trunk and head alignment, pelvic stability, leg and foot placement, weight distribution, and syempre comfort. In result of that, students' capacity to focus is aided by strong postural control and alignment, which also enhances arm-hand coordination, enhances reading and writing, and conserves energy. Third is to place a non-skid mat on the chair. We all know na ang mga students or yung mga naging classmates natin na mayroong physical disabilities ay kailangan ng pag-iingat to avoid physical injuries. At ang isa sa mga katulong sa kanila ang paglalagay ng non-skid mats. Anti-skid mats are layers of patterned rubber or plastic that are placed on the ground and must be under their chair. Kaya sa mga areas na possible maging madulas kapag basa, makakatulong sa kanilang anti-skid mats to prevent injuries from accidental falls. Lastly, provide opportunities for movement breaks. Kung alamin natin kung ano nga ba yung movement breaks, they are short periods that allow all pupils to move their bodies and assist teachers in physically engaging pupils. Students with physical disabilities have been shown to benefit from movement breaks, which have been proven to improve concentration and focus. Furthermore, they have been found to improve the efficacy of learning in general. We may take breaks throughout the day with chants, poems, and even welcomes and activities during morning meetings. The third one is schedule. When dealing with kids who have physical limitations, teachers must be adaptable. Correct scheduling for them may enable them to become unconcerned with regards to time management inside the classroom. We can help them overcome their problems by doing the following. Allow for extra time to complete tests and writing assignments. Mahirap naman kasi talaga sa sitwasyon nila ang makapagsulat dahil sa hirap sila humawak ng pencil o ballpen. Pero since they are still intellectually active at may willingness to learn, kaya kahit ganun sila ay huwag nating sayangan ang kakayahan ng bata sa pag-aaral. At i-encourage natin sila na masagutan ng maayos ang mga written assignments at matapos ang exams by providing them extra time. Next is, provide extra time to change for physical education classes. While students with physical difficulties are experiencing challenges in executing movements, kaya pag PE time, need din nila ng extra time. If kaya nila mag-bis mag-isa, give him or her a privacy para makapag-bis siya ng walang ilang-ilang, but since karamihan sa disabled ay need ng assistance, express your willingness to assist them para save time din and makapag-klase ng physical education class ng sapat sa oras. Aside sa mga naunang type of accommodations, may mga iba pang ways para ma-accommodate natin ng maayos yung mga estudyante natin na may physical disabilities while we are inside and outside the school premises. We may still help them manage their troubles by photocopy notes and homework reminders for the child. Having homework for students encourages their self-development and self-discipline. But karamihan ng may DCD at SMD ay struggled sa pagsulat, so when the class ends, pagbigyan natin sila if nice na nila magpahinga, so they don't want to write the instruction for their homeworks anymore. Kaya as a teacher, you may give them photocopies of the homework as an alternative, or pwede din na ikaw na lang ang magsulat ng mga reminders in their notebook kung ano ba yung mga worksheets na gagawin sa bahay so that matutulungan siya ng kanyang family by assisting him or her inside their homes. Second is to allow to take photos of notes and homework reminders. This is an alternative way kung hindi kaya ng students with physical disabilities na makapagsulat ng handouts for the homework. Kung naisulat mo lamang sa board ang homework and reminders, encourage them to use their gadgets to take pictures. Maaari din na ikaw na lamang ang kumuha ng litrato ng assignments para sa kanila, or kung alam na nila ang text-to-speech feature sa devices ay maaaring magawa nila mag-take ng pictures in their own. Third is to give advance organizers. Before a lesson, lecture to lesson, and remove writing tasks. If we give them advanced lessons, these can be a help for them to perform an advanced study so that mapapadali yung pag-cope up nila sa mga topic ni teacher during the discussion. A student's attention might change in a variety of ways while sitting in a lecture, kaya it is easy sa kanila na ma-distract during class dahil sa kung anong nangyayari sa paligid nila. It will be simpler for students to take in and digest the learning if you approach the lesson with a few broad ideas or minimize the value of other topics throughout the class. In the long run, assisting students in choosing the most important topics will result in more learning, not less. We encouraged as teachers to remove writing tasks since kahinaan nila sa klase ang magsulat. Instead, magpa-recitation na lang kasi kaya pa nila ma-express yung gusto nilang sabihin sa teacher through short words and sentences. Lastly, send lecture handouts via email. Finally, since students nowadays ay magaling na sa paggamit ng internet-based gadgets, pati na din ang mga physically disabled na benefit ng mga high-tech equipments, we can send lecture handouts, worksheets, and homeworks via email. Nowadays, distance learning, We should encourage their parents to check every time their inboxes kapag may dumadating na soft copy ng homework after the synchronous learning para makapaggawa sila ng activities asynchronously. And that's it. I will wrap up our presentation by ending this quote to all of you by Nido Cobain. Your present circumstances don't determine where you can go. They merely determine where you start. That's all for today. So, in behalf of my groupmates, thank you very much guys for listening and stay healthy and safe.